we had known for some time that today's program was going to be slightly different than the Yom Hashoahs we've experienced together in years past. Today's program is in memory of Fela and Abraham Kolat, who was Mrs. Geller's parents, the great-grandparents of our own Zach Wolf. And they themselves were Holocaust survivors. Their memory should be a blessing. As I searched for the meaning and the message that I wanted to be able to impart to everyone, specifically this year, in the context of everything that's going on around the world, us and how that connects to Yom Hashoah, I was at a loss for words. And then I saw a short video that I think really brings home perhaps the message that we're all feeling. So please, throughout the program, we'll have different videos. Please turn your attention to the main screen and you'll see this video.
רציתי להגיד לך, אני בדיוק מתכונן פה לטיסה ואנחנו הולכים לעבור מעל הבית שלך. אם את רוצה לעלות לגג, תוכלי לראות אותי.
טוב, בהצלחה.
ביי.
הייתי בת שמונה וברחנו לפני הפגזה גרמנית, שכבנו בשדה תפוחי אדמה, והמטוסים של גרמנים ירו בכל דבר שזז. ראיתי נכד שלי במטוס ישראלי.
אני מרגישה גאווה ממנו.
אני מאוד מתרגשת.
I think we all saw there that the story of the woman who's a Holocaust survivor, who as a youngster had to hide in the fields as the German planes flew overhead, and here she is unable to communicate with her, unable to communicate in person with her grandson, who's an IDF pilot, but he flies over. And that's part of what we're feeling today, because so much of today is about having a communal experience, about coming together as a community to remember and to show those who wish to demolish us, who wish to wipe us out, that we are strong and we are vibrant. And so when we do this alone and in our own homes, on some level, it puts an even greater responsibility on all of us. All of us have unique responsibility today that we can't rely on someone else to zachor, to remember. We can't look to the person to the left. We can't look to the person to the right. Instead, it's on us. Today, Zachor, it's on us. Each one of us has a unique responsibility in our own way, in our homes today, to try to remember to make some sense out of the different messages of the Shoah. Yad Vashem, which is obviously the most important institution in the world when it comes to remembering the Holocaust, the museum in Israel. So Yad Vashem every year has its flagship event where many, many survivors come, where many, many dignitaries come, and they have a big program. this year they had their program, but unfortunately it was really only attended by a handful of people who all social distanced. It was attended by, of course, the Prime Minister, Bibi Netanyahu, by the head of the museum. But the survivors, who normally are what they refer to as the yearly torchbearers, the ones who light the candles, were unable to be at the ceremony last night. So instead Yad Vashem placed the videos of these survivors giving their short testimonies in their tekes. They played it and they put it on YouTube. We wanted to take today just a few moments to maybe look at one or two of those stories to give some perspective to this day. The first video we'll watch tells the story of Menachem Haberman. Menachem Haberman was in a whole series of camps, and you'll hear his story. But perhaps what's most impressive about Menachem Haberman's story is the religious heroism he shows in the face of the greatest persecution. The fact that when he had a chance to do a mitzvah, he wasn't going to be stopped, but he was going to do whatever he could in order to try to fill that mitzvah, even in the face of the greatest evil. The second story, the story of Aviva Blumwack, is an example of a different type of resistance, of a physical resistance, of the resistance in the Warsaw Ghetto, and how against the hardest odds, the Jewish spirit would not be put down. And we looked in the face of our enemies and we told them that we are humans, we are people, we have a spirit, and we will stand up for that. So we'll turn our attention to these videos and take their words to heart.
שני שליש על התושבים במונקאץ' היו יהודים, ואנחנו היינו משפחה מאוד מאוד דתית. הגרמנים הגיעו למונקאץ' בתחילת מרץ 44. גייסו אותנו, הילדים, לעבודות, חפרנו תעלות. כל בוקר אמא קשרה לי את שתי הפאות, והיה לי קשקט כזה, ככה שלא ראו שיש לי פאות. יום אחד, הפאה השתחררה לי, השומר הוציא עולר, תפס לי את הפאה עם האור חתך. אח שלי הקטן בימין, כבר יומיים היה לו חום, אני מחזיק את האח שלי, מדבר איתו, מדשק אותו. את אמא ושישה אחים ואחיות לקחו לצד איפה שהיה מבנה גדול. אנחנו לא יודעים מה זה סלקציה, רק אחר כך ידענו. ועוד שנתתי את האח שלי הקטן לידם של אמא, הוא הסתובב אליי והיו לו דמעות ביניים, עשה לי שלום עם היד הקטנה הקטנה. זה אני לא יכול לשכוח. באושוויץ אני הייתי בקבוצה שעבדנו עם סוסים, טיפלנו בהם. אני הובלתי עם עגלה קדים של חלף, ומהרפת לעגלה, שהיא לא הייתה כל כך קרובה, הייתי צריך לקחת קד אחד ביד וקד אחד על הגב. כל קד 30 קילו, כל פעם 15 קדים. ב-13 לינואר 45 הוציאו אותנו למצד המוות. אחרי יומיים, כבר שלושה, היינו צריכים להסתכל, לא לדרוך על הגביעות שהיו בדרך. בבוכנוולד, עם כל התנאים הרעים שהיה לנו, היה בלוק אחד, 59, שהיו שם תפילין רק של ראש, ושם עמדנו בתור בקור בחוץ בכדי להיכנס, להניח התפילין של הראש ולהגיד שמה ישראל. אני נשארתי בחיים, עליתי ארצה וקמתי משפחה, שלושה ילדים וחמישה נכדים. ואחרי 50 שנה אני חזרתי לפולין למצעד החיים. הבן שלי, סגן אלוף בחיל אוויר, הדליק נשואה כנציג של צבא הגנה לישראל, והוא נקרא על השם של אח שלי הקטן בנימין. וזה מרגש אותי, וזה הניצחון שלי.
One of the ways that Jews expressed themselves wasn't just through religion, wasn't just through physical resistance, but it was through art, it was through poetry. To share with us a reading, please give your attention to Dr. Feldblum.
Yom Hashoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day, is a day when we are reminded of the worst humanity is capable of. We are forced to think about hate, violence, cruelty, and mass murder, but we must also remember the ways in which our brethren held on to their humanity. They used any vehicle imaginable to accomplish this, including poetry. Pavel Friedman was born on January 7th, 1921, in Prague. In 1942, when Pavel was only 21 years old, he was deported to Terezin. He died in Auschwitz 2 years later on September 29, 1944. He wrote this poem in captivity, The Butterfly. The last, the very last, so richly, brightly, dazzlingly yellow. Perhaps if the sun's tears would sing against a white stone, such a yellow is carried lightly way up high. It went away, I'm sure, because it wished to kiss the world goodbye. For 7 weeks I've lived in here, penned up inside this ghetto, but I have found my people here. The dandelions call to me and the white chestnut candles in the court. Only I never saw another butterfly. That butterfly was the last one. Butterflies don't live here in the ghetto.
אני מציירת ציורים מופשטים. אין שם אנשים ועצמים מוגדרים. יש כתמים ויש צבעים. אני לא מציירת בשביל לזכור. אני מציירת בשביל לשכוח. בתקופת הגטו, אמי לובה הייתה מנהלת של בית הספר לאחיות בתוך בית החולים. היה שם חדר לרשותה. אני ואחי גרנו יחד איתה באותו חדר. שני ההורים שלי היו חברי בונד מצעירותם. תנועת הבונד דוגלת באידיאולוגיה שיהודים צריכים להישאר במקום איפה שהם חיים ולהשתתף במאבק הסוציאליסטי של הפועלים. בתקופת הגטו, אבי אברשה היה מנהיג הבונד, הוציא את העיתונות המחתרתית, ואבי הוא זה ששכנע את הבונד להצטרף לארגון היהודי הלוחם. ובתנאים הנוראים האלה של הגטו, אמי הצליחה לקבל ולהחזיק 30 תלמידות בתוך בית הספר. ובעצם זאת הייתה תעודת חיים לאחיות האלה. האחיות למדו והם עבדו בבית חולים. היו כמה מקרים שתפסו את החיות והביאו אותם לאוגשלג פרץ, ואז אמי פשוט הוציאה אותם משם. היא הייתה אישה מאוד אמיצה, הייתה מורידה את הסרט של מגן דוד שחייבים ללבוש, בביטחון מוחלט עוברת דרך משמרות של הגרמנים לצד הארץ. בגלל הקשרים שהיו לה שם, היא סידרה מקום מחבוא למספר ילדים. יום אחד נודע לנו אבא שלי ומהארגון היהודי הלוחם שמתוכננת פעולה של הגרמנים ממש לפני שהם באו. היא הצליחה להוריד למרתף כמה חולים, כמה אחיות וכמה רופאים וגם אותי ואת אחי. הגרמנים נכנסו לבית החולים ופשוט ירו בכולם ואנחנו ניצלנו מהטבח. בזמן המרד, אבי היה בבית חרושת למברשות. שם הייתה חוליה בהנהגתו של מרק אדלמן. הוא עסק בהכנת בקבוקי מולוטוב, והוא היה אחד המבוגרים מבית כל הלוחמים. הוריי לא חשבו על עצמם, ובתנאים הנוראים האלה של הגטו, הם חשבו על מה שנדרש לעשות למען הקהילה, למען אנשים אחרים. אני בהחלט רואה בהם גיבורים.
The Holocaust was not merely an isolated event between 1939 and 1945. Its reverberations, its impacts has been felt for generations. So many of us, the grandchildren or children or great-grandchildren of survivors have grown up with the stories, and it's very much framed our outlooks and our perspectives. I know that my close friend and colleague, Rabbi Speer, who is a grandson of a survivor himself, much of his outlook and his perspective was framed by the experiences he shared with his grandfather, Mr. Walter Speer, who was a survivor. Please give your attention to Rabbi Speer as he introduces the next part of the program.
Rabbi Yisrael Meir Lau, former chief rabbi of Israel, wrote a very compelling book titled Out of the Depths. In his introduction, he writes, "Over time, the blazing flames of the survivors have died down to glowing embers, which by their very nature dwindle until they are extinguished. I am attempting to fan the flames of these embers so that they will never die out. I hope that my story will touch the consciousness of readers and bestir them to think again, to search their souls, and perhaps even to conclude that despite all the enigmas posed by the Holocaust, I will walk before the Lord, in the land of the living." As a grandson of a Holocaust survivor, this message by Rabbi Lau really resonated. Growing up hearing stories from my grandfather put the Holocaust in my consciousness in a very, very strong way. It reminded me that the responsibility to learn and carry on these messages falls squarely on each and every single one of us, both faculty and students alike. Every year since 1986, at the gates of Auschwitz concentration camp, Rabbi Lau has addressed the March of the Living tour group to share his story and life lessons. Unfortunately, due to the current circumstances, he was not able to be there this year. However, we wanted to show you some clips of his speeches from a few years ago. Listen carefully and remember, it is now on us.
I told 3 days ago in a conference of survivors in Tel Aviv University, two of them are here among you, I told them a very short story, maybe the second episode of the war that I do remember. I was that time less than 5.5 years old. October 42. My father, who served as the chief rabbi of our city in Poland, not very far from here, Piotrków Trybunalski, he was told that the last action, the last transport of the Jews from Piotrków is going to somewhere. And the first two transport never came back. No one returned from their first and the second transport. So he understood that this is the final way. He called my mother, said, "I prepared for you a place where to hide, a shelter. You see, there is an empty building, all the Jews left already. In the fourth floor, there is a room. In that room, you find an attic. You can see the door to that attic. In that attic, you will hide together with other 10 people. Prepare food, prepare water for 2 or 3 days till the transport, till the action will come to an end." I was there with my mother, and on the second or the third day, I can't remember, we have heard the boots of the Gestapo people marching up and up from one stair to the other, from one floor to the other, closer and closer, and the doors knocked open and close and open and close, an empty building, the boots of the Gestapo, I will never forget, until they came and they reached the same room. And they were in that room. Before they entered, my mother pushed to my mouth honey cookies that she baked at home for that particular moment. a child. He can ask a question. He can just cry. He can say, Mama. He can ask Lachego, why? So first of all, to close his mouth with those cookies. I looked at her, telling her with my eyes, Mama, it's not necessary, I understand. I see the eyes of horror from all the 10 people looking at me, the child. I can bring them all to the death. 50 years later, 48 years later, serving as chief rabbi of Tel Aviv, my first cadence, and man with a nice white beard came to my office. He was not on the line, he was not in the schedule, but he said, I'm going back to London, I live in London, and before I leave, I must take from you 5 minutes. Who are you? My name is Motel Kaminsky. My name is Motel Kaminsky. I was with you in that attic, in Dembojtin, in Piotrków. I was sent after the war to England. I was brought up in Manchester. I live now in London. I insisted on to meet you before I leave back home to London, because I must ask you forgiveness before I give back my soul to the master of the universe. Forgiveness? You have to ask me forgiveness? For what? Before the Gestapo came into that room, I was so hungry. My father and mother were sent away by train before. I was alone. No one prepared for me any food. With empty hands, I came to that attic, to that room. And you had some apples with you. And I stole an apple from you. I took it in my mouth, but then they arrived, the Gestapo. I couldn't eat it because it makes a noise. And if it makes a noise, I send 10 people, including myself, to their death. I held it in my mouth an hour or two, till they left the room. I cannot give back my soul until you forgive me for stealing an apple from you, the child of the rabbi whom we admired, and I stole from you something. When he passed away in Jerusalem, I told on his funeral this story. He came to ask me forgiveness. Those who killed us, who tortured us, did they ask someone forgiveness? Please, Jewish people, forgive us. When did it happen? Never. When did you hear it? Never. Eichmann stood in Jerusalem in the trial a long time. Did he ask once upon a time, forgive me, Jewish people, for this destruction, for this darkness, for this tragedy? Who asked forgiveness? All the assistants of the Nazi German were not. In Ukraine, in Hungary, in Romania, here in Poland, in Germany, wherever. No one asked forgiveness. We had to learn a lot after 70 years, but not hatred. We must bless the Lord Almighty for being different, for behaving different. Our Torah that I carry here with me, this Torah is also a survivor. A Jew from Poland brought it 50 years ago to Israel. It was half Torah. The Torah scroll was burned and torn. I had to fix it 4 months to make it kosher. The Torah is a survivor. We demonstrate here our eternity, emphasizing the very, very simple point. that the Nazi German declared a war not only against the Jews, but also against Judaism. Not only a physical war, but a spiritual as well. The first thing they made, the first pogrom, was the Kristallnacht. Over 1,000 synagogues burned and destroyed in one night between the 8th and the 9th of November 38, 10 months before World War II broke out. They understood that the heart of the Jewish people is the synagogue with the Torah inside in the Ark, in the Holy Ark. They destroyed over 1,000 of them. This was the first step officially of the Nazi Germany. So we want to emphasize that we exist, that we survived, and our heritage, our holy tradition is for eternity, is immortal.
Question that we often pose, how do you respond to such images? How do you respond to such evil? And as Jews, you respond first and foremost through prayer. You pray to Kadosh Baruch Hu on behalf of those precious neshamos. We pray that Kadosh Baruch Hu should make sure that our people have no more suffering in the world. We also commit ourselves to living lives of love, lives of goodness and kindness, and being there for our immediate community, our broader community, and of course the world community, so that such evils never ever replicated, God forbid, ever again. In a moment, Rabbi Schachter will lead us in the Kel Mole, traditional prayer that we sing, that we say, in memory of those who have perished. In the background, you'll see an artwork by our very own Kayla Kirschenbaum from the 11th grade, which was part of the Art Tracks Shema and Holocaust virtual exhibition. We will send out a link to the entire exhibition today so you can see the work that was done by them. But that is the beginning, that is part of our responsibility to remember, and to do something on behalf of the 6 million, and to be people that continue their stories. Rabbi Lau, we saw continued the stories. We saw Mr. Haberman and Mrs. Wach continuing the stories. And it's our responsibility to continue those stories. In whichever medium we choose, let's take upon ourselves to perpetuate their stories and the stories of our people. Before the Kel Mole, we'll have a quick moment of silence where we'll virtually light the candles in memory of the 6 million. Please give your attention to Rabbi Schachter.
We say the Kel Mole as we daven that the people whose lives were cut too short have everlasting life in Shemayim with Hashem. El Mole Rachamim Shochein Meromim Dayami Yisomim Hametzei Minucha Nechona Al kanfei hashchina b'malos kidoshim utehorim kizohar harakia mirim mazhirim v'nishmoseihem shel revivos alfei Yisrael anashim Vinashim Yeladim Vilados Shenehergu Vinishchatu Vinisrifu Vinechniku Vinigberu Chayim Baratzos Asher Nagabahen Yad HaTzorer HaGermanim Kulam Kidoshim Utehorim Uvahem Geonim Vitzadikim Arzei HaLevanon Adirei HaTorah Vegan Eden Tehei Minuchasam Lochein Bal Harachamim Yastirein Viseser Kinahav Leolamim Visror Gritzror Hachayim Es Nishmasam Adonai Hu Nachalasam Vianuchu Vishalom Al Mishkavam Vinomar, amen.
Rabbi Lau, who we just saw a few moments ago, tells a story that when he was in Israel and he was a young boy and he was approaching adolescence and he wanted to read the Diary of Anne Frank. The Diary of Anne Frank was a popular book at that point that gave an insight into the time period of the Holocaust. And his adoptive parents, he says, didn't allow him. They spoke to psychologists and they wanted Rabbi Lau, who had seen the horrors of the Shoah firsthand, who had experienced them, they wanted him to slowly try and forget it. They wanted him to forget the Polish language and they wanted him to try and start a new life. And Rabbi Lau explains, like any child or even adult, he says, when something's not allowed, they want it more. And they want to try and in this case, read it, even though he wasn't allowed to. And he says, one time he was babysitting and he saw on the bookshelf, the Diary of Anne Frank, and he read it. And after he read it, he said to himself, this is what everybody wants to read. This doesn't say the Shoah. This is one young girl hiding out in an attic. This isn't the atrocities. I saw the atrocities. This doesn't come close to it. This is a story of a young girl's dreams when she was in hiding. There was one page about Auschwitz. That's it. And he couldn't understand why the world was so fascinated by this diary. He said he grew a little bit, and as he reflected and saw the world and the Holocaust and more came, more information came out, he realized why the Diary of Anne Frank was so popular, why so many people were so fascinated by it. When you talk about 6 million, it's very hard to understand and internalize the horrors that were done. You're talking about numbers, abstractions, but the Diary of Anne Frank was the first story of the Holocaust. It was the first time that an individual, not a number, was able to be spoken about, and it was the first time that an individual, not some abstract concept, actually created an impact and a memory in the minds of the world. And Rabbi Lau said, as an educational takeaway from this, we must learn about individuals. He said it's important to learn about the timelines, about how evil began in the 30s, and about how ultimately the final solution came about. And that's critical. And it's important to know about 6 million. But it's more important to understand and learn about the individuals. And that's why I think it's so important to show those pictures. Rabbi Goldfischer often asks me if we should still show the pictures, even though we've seen them year after year, even though we've seen them since first, second, third grade. My daughter, Tiferet, is sitting with me right now. She's named after Yonina's grandmother who went through Auschwitz. And she saw those pictures. And we're going to see those pictures year after year because they remind us and they need to be branded into our memory that these were individuals and the individual stories must stay with us. And I thank Rabbi Goldfischer for introducing us today to three more individuals. And we need to take their stories, we need to learn from their stories. And as Rabbi Goldfischer appropriately said, we need to let those stories inspire us to remember them and to create action.